It might seem strange to do a video focusing on mental health to kind of wrap up the end of a year, but I think it's important because the end of the year, whether you set resolutions or not, it kind of signifies the closing of one chapter and the starting of a new one. Realistically, the same mess that was waiting for you in December is waiting for you in January, but if you can't have those moments of feeling like starting over, you know, then what's the point? So this is a period of time that means a lot to some people, and if your life has been going particularly bad, the end of the year might seem like a bad time. So I wanted to take the opportunity at the very end of 2022 to talk about some major improvements in my own mental health that I've seen throughout this year in a very tangible way. If this video travels outside of my normal guitar playing audience, the short version is I'm an online guitar instructor who sells courses and has been making content online for 15 years. And along the way, I became a parent right around the same time that this became my career. And so I've had two kids, and parenthood has been hard. It has taken every bit of energy that I have, and I've still had to balance running a business with it. And so that all kind of, I've struggled with depression and anxiety most of my adult life, even going back to my high school years. I took some time a couple years ago during Mental Health Awareness Month to make a video about it, and I've received countless emails from people thanking me for doing that. And so I haven't addressed it since then because nothing really changed. You know, I was in this state where I'm taking medication. It keeps things mostly okay, but when bad things happen around me, my mental health gets a little bit worse, but I still make it through. And I considered it a condition that I just had to deal with. And this year, I have seen the first big improvement, not just in my overall mental health, but an improvement in my outlook on my mental health. And I'm going to detail that for you. And I'll say this right now. If you stop watching the video before the last 10 minutes or so, you are going to miss the main part. I'm going to walk right through this year and talk about how I got there. And then at the end, I'm going to share with you some things that have been absolutely life-changing for me. So let me talk about how last year ended right around this time. So COVID, the whole pandemic in general, was very rough for me. We took it very seriously. Kids were home from school. My working hours got cut drastically. And if I can't work, I feel lost. And so there were periods throughout 2020 and 2021 where I lost the ability to think long term about Texas Blues Alley. It was literally, what do I need to do to keep the business running today? And that is all I could think about. And so going into fall 2021, I was just essentially running on creative fumes. Around the same time, typically the end of the year is where, if I've struggled creatively throughout most of the year, the end of the year is where I kind of get everything together. And so I was working on an extremely large course at the end of 2021, despite mostly running on fumes. A whole bunch of situations that had been building throughout 2021 came to a head all in the months of November and December. Some people very close to our family almost died from COVID, spending, you know, combined weeks in the hospital. My wife having to, you know, be there. And I mean, it was chaotic. And around the same time, we had a project that we had dreamed about just completely fall through because of a dishonest contractor who ended up not only stealing money from us, but taking money from a loan that we then had to pay back just to get out of it. So that was all coming due around the same time. And then a situation from earlier in the year where a big tree got struck by lightning and almost fell on our house. And we had some people come cut it down, and then homeowners decided they're not going to cover it. The bill for that was all coming due at the same time. And so I run my own business, and my wife is a professor over at the university here. And so she has the schedule from hell. She has actual real commitments and appointments and everything. So she's in the end of this. Anybody who works in higher education will tell you that the end of the semester is just an awful time because you're crammed with end of year testing and finals and emails from students trying to get a better grade. And all this is happening while she's got to care for people in the hospital and we've got these financial things. So I kind of, because I'm trying to finish this course, and I'm sure some of you guys can relate to this, I kind of went into this mode where I just kind of shelled up and I was kind of in survival mode. And it was just like I saw the things happening around me, but I just pretended that it was normal. I pretended that it was okay for me to ignore it, and I just pretended that everything was okay. So when I would come down here to the studio to work on this course, I just kind of tactically, strategically forgot about everything else, all the chaos that was going on, and I just buckled down and I tried to finish this course so I could get it out by Christmas. And keep in mind, this is all coming at the end of a year and a half, 2 years of just kind of gradually running on empty and fumes, and I'm just kind of compartmentalizing it all. And that is not healthy, but it was necessary for me to get through. So we go through the end of the year, we've got no energy left for Christmas. We're just lucky that everyone we love is alive. We not totally broke, but we lost a bunch of money with those situations that came up. And we just kind of slide into the new year, kind of like the movies where the door's coming down and you run and you just slide and you get under the door before it comes down. That's kind of what it felt like getting into the new year. But the funny thing about pressure in life is that sometimes external pressure, external situations that confine your actions, there's sometimes where you don't have wiggle room. The situations or the circumstances around you dictate how you can act. That can act as a funnel to keep you moving forward. If, you know, you want to keep your house, you have to go to your work. If you want to not die of starvation, you have to keep buying food. Like, there's things that can happen to you that are realities that keep you motivated to do something. But once, if you find yourself in a situation where the external pressures all kind of recede, that's when you find out what kind of integrity you're wired with as a person. So when the external forces keeping you productive and keeping you focused all kind of disappear, I've learned that that's when it's really easy to just kind of fall apart and lose your motivation. That's exactly what happened to me coming into the new year. So as January rolled on and turned into February, I kind of felt like I had been kind of skating on ice for a while, pulling a sled that was slowly getting heavier and heavier with emotional baggage from things that had happened over the past year. And as long as I kept skating, I had the power of momentum and I could stay in front of it. But as soon as I slowed down, the momentum of that sled was just going to knock me over. So I just tried to stay busy. But every once in a while, I would come down here to the studio and something very strange would happen. I would sit down to kind of catch my breath. And if I stayed sitting for too long, all of the grief and the frustration and the sadness and the anger from 2021 would just land on top of me. And I would just be like, done. No creative energy for the rest of the day. And keep in mind, 90% of my job is creative. There's some mindless work that I do, but for the most part, if I'm not right up here, I can't do anything with my job. And so when a foul mood strikes me and I get depressed or if I get anxious, it is very hard to do anything productive with my business. So if I would sit there for too long, I would wind up feeling like I'm being crushed by the weight of everything that we just went through. And I would just end up laying on the couch here in the studio for like hours, unable to do anything. Sometimes I would fall asleep for a couple hours. And the thing is, it never was getting better. I didn't even know how, when I thought about the things that had happened, I still did not feel any sadness. I didn't feel anything. And that's a scary thing. When you go through something that should be, should evoke grief or sadness, and you don't feel anything, you know, like your wiring's not right. So I knew I was not in a good place. And because I'm kind of an introvert by nature, when I'm going through something like that, it takes my introversion and turns it up to 11 out of 10. And there's a certain part of my job that requires interacting with people, most of all my members, and then making videos for everybody out there on YouTube and whatever. And I can't fake it. I don't have that thing where I can put on a happy face when things are chaotic. Pretty much how my life is going is kind of how it is reflected in my public work. It'd be nice if I had that skill, but I don't. So February turns into March, March turns into April, and where I live in the Northeast here in Pennsylvania, spring is an awesome time. It is beautiful, and so the weather's turning good. All the stressful things that we've been through are all behind us. I should be feeling better, but I'm not. This is still happening. I go to sit down, and my motivation for work just disappears. And if those of you who haven't dealt with depression is not always sadness. Depression robs you of the enjoyment of something that you legitimately enjoy, whether it's fishing, whether it's a sport, in my case, whether it's my work. Sometimes people confuse burnout and depression, but they're really two different things. Burnout is a longer term, somewhat more permanent phenomenon where there's a certain activity that you burned out on and you just cannot come back to it, because when you do, your mental and emotional state just seizes up and you can't do it. Depression can be like that, but for a limited period of time. Sometimes it's a few hours. Sometimes it's a few days. In some cases, it's weeks. But then if the depression lifts, you come back to it like nothing ever happened. So that's the difference between burnout and depression, is that burnout is the truth. Depression is a lie. If you're really burnt out, then you're really burnt out. Depression makes you feel burnt out, but you're really not. It just takes all of your drive and your passion and your interest and all the feel-good stuff that you typically get from an activity you enjoy, and it just drains it all away. So that coming down here to work in an awesome studio feels functionally no different from having to go out and shovel snow. Shoveling snow might be even more enjoyable because it's something that you don't expect to get enjoyment from. Imagine if you have kids, and especially if you have a child like one of mine is, where they're just super cuddly, happy all the time. A kid that is fairly easy to parent. Imagine if you have a child like that, and typically your heart leaps when you see them. But one day you come downstairs and it's like looking at somebody else's child. You feel nothing. It's just another person in your house. That's what depression does to you when it's on you. It takes something that should bring feelings of joy and it just renders it flat gray, and there's nothing. And that's a very disorienting feeling. And so that's what I was dealing with trying to come to work is all the baggage of the past year would just land on me, and all the joy of everything around me would just, and I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand working. I couldn't stand interacting with people, not my members, you know, not putting videos on YouTube. And occasionally a good day would come and I'd be, you know, I'd trying to strike while the iron's hot and make a video. But for the most part, I was just surviving and assuming that at some point this is going to get better, but I didn't know how. And so I wouldn't even say I hit rock bottom. I was just like a car with no back wheels, just the axle dragging on the ground, but the front wheels still go, could still pull it around. I was just going, but not very fast, not very enjoyable, just kind of bleak and gray. And one of the first things that I remember when things started to turn around is my wife told me, she said, it seems like you are more prone to having these bad days when you're not getting enough sleep. And I thought about it. I was like, you know what? She is absolutely right. If I have been getting enough sleep, I have more insulation to being affected by depression and anxiety. And so the first thing I did is I started paying a lot more attention to how much cumulative sleep I'm getting. If I have a single night where I get like 6 hours, I don't think much of it and I just power on through. But if I start having 2, 3, 4 nights in a row where I get 6 or less hours of sleep, now a warning light goes off in my head and I realize you need to be on high alert because this is when you are most vulnerable to the subversive effects of anxiety and depression. So number one, I tried to start going to bed earlier. But the other thing I did is I started taking naps. And I realized not everybody's in a situation where they can take naps, but I am. But I used to just try and power through. If I got up in the morning and I was groggy, I would just power through. And I've lost a lot of days like that because I'd start off groggy. I'd feel bad about not having any energy, and then the anxiety would give way to depression and it would just be a mess. So what I started doing this year that I've not really done in 15 years of being self-employed is I just gave myself permission to take as many naps for as long as I needed to until I felt right. And I quickly realized that sleep for me makes me a completely different person. If I wake up some morning and I'm not feeling good, if I'm somewhat depressed and I'm tired and I feel sluggish, I can literally be one 90-minute nap away from being a completely different person. And that's not an exaggeration. I have had this happen more times than I can count this year where I wasn't disciplined with my sleep. I wake up in the morning, I do what's necessary to get my kids to school. I come home and I go straight back to bed and I sleep from 9 to 10:30 and I wake up and it's like all of a sudden the sun came out and I'm a different person. So the big change for me is that I have accepted that for me personally, sleep is non-negotiable because me without sleep is like going out into the snow without a coat. It's just pointless. I am very vulnerable to, whether it's hereditary or whatever, my predisposition to anxiety and depression. Sleep helps give me a layer of insulation against that. And if I don't do that, I'm fighting an uphill battle. So paying attention to sleep and regarding it as non-negotiable is a positive change that I've made this year. The second big change is that I was able to reframe some of the things that I do for my job. So my job has many different aspects. Where the money is made is on my site in my membership program, making courses that members then pay to study. Then there's the other part of the job, which is how my company started, which is making free content for the world. And I've been, as the business side grew, I've been spending more and more time working on features for that and courses for that, and not prioritizing the free stuff. Now, the problem is doing stuff for free for the world is relatively easy. It is quick, and it has a very quick cycle of creation to feedback. It is where I can experience the most connectedness with my audience the quickest. The paid stuff is much longer term, much more planning, much lower rate of put something out, feedback. You know, I feel much less connected to my members in that sense because they're paying money to study one course at a time or multiple courses. A new video that I put out doesn't generate the same amount of excitement for somebody who's neck deep into some soloing course as a free video does for somebody who's just cruising through YouTube. And what I discovered this year is that producing free content is something that I have looked at as a burden that I do when everything else in my business allows me enough time. But one of the struggles that I have had throughout my career, and especially early this year, is a feeling of disassociation, where because my business is entirely online, I start to forget who I am. My sense of self starts to get diluted a little bit because I'm working on programming on the site and I'm working on courses for the members and everything, or I'm, you know, doing some renovation projects for my barn, and I start to lose that sense of I look in the mirror and I recognize who I'm looking at. And that feeling of who am I comes more blurred. What I realized is that producing this free content, the act of planning, shooting, editing, and publishing, and then promoting a video in the course of an afternoon, that is not a chore. That is a ritual. I love every part of that process. And I had been denying myself week after week after week. I had been denying myself the luxury of taking the time to do this workflow that I love so much because I kept telling myself that's not the important stuff. This stuff over here is the important stuff. But in the process, I was just killing my sense of identity one little bit at a time. And I can't remember exactly when it snapped, but it finally dawned on me. When I'm in one of those places where I feel lost professionally and I don't feel like the owner of Texas Blues Alley, a guitar player, a guitar teacher, one of the quickest ways back from that is to think of a video that I've been wanting to do but have never given myself the luxury of doing and just pour myself into it, focus on enjoying every part of the process, make the video as good as I can, and put it out. Because when I do that, it almost doesn't matter how many people watch it. I've already gotten the reward out of it, because when I do that, that's like, you know, a carpenter who has been putting in nails for 30 years. If you take him away from that and he doesn't get to build anything, it's like you don't feel like yourself because you're not doing this thing that you've done. For me, creating these videos and putting them out, that's like the feeling of hammering that nail. And so every time I do one of those videos, it is a reminder that what I do is a real thing. I produce real stuff, even if it's only online, but it has a tangible effect on real people because I get the immediate feedback from the people that watch it. And so at some point, late spring, early summer, I just realized, what am I doing? It's not that I have to put out this stuff on YouTube because I make my money from memberships. I don't depend on YouTube revenue, but I get to do that. I have the opportunity to do it, and I'm shutting myself off from this thing that I love doing because it doesn't make business sense. And so I realized at that point that there is no ROI that can be measured, return on investment that can be measured for doing these free videos. If I spend a week doing a video that I love and it ends up less than a couple thousand people watch it, I've already gotten the primary benefit from it just by having allowed myself to do it, because it contributes to my sense of wholeness and my sense of identity, and it helps me to remember who I am and what I do. So that's all. That brings us into end of June, July. So already two big things that have improved. I'm focusing on my sleep more, and I've gotten back to doing something that I love after years of kind of considering it a nuisance. And so this is where things actually start going really, really well, because I finally started therapy, like real going to a therapist, not just going to a counselor, somebody who will listen to you, but going to a licensed and trained therapist. And I just want to say, therapy in general is worth whatever you put into it financially if you have a good therapist. But in general, it is too expensive. It should be more accessible to more people. If you're somebody who's struggling with your mental health, it should not cost you a significant part of your salary to go see a therapist. But unfortunately, that is very much the case in a lot of parts of our country. I opted with BetterHelp, which is a service you've no doubt seen ads about. But I decided to give it a try. This is not an ad for BetterHelp, because I am sure that there are people who tried BetterHelp and got matched up with a therapist that wasn't very good, and so they're negative about it. That was not my experience. This is only based on what has happened to me. So I told my wife, I said, I think I'm going to sign up for BetterHelp, because there's a lot of things that have happened over the past 2 years that we've been through together, but I need to talk to a third party about it, because when we talk about it, it just makes our lives worse because we've both been through it. We need somebody who wasn't there. I need to be able to kind of unload some of this stuff that I've been carrying. And so she was all for it, so I went. And basically, BetterHelp, at least where I'm at in the United States, is $390 every 4 weeks. It's about, or $360. It's $90 for a half-hour session once a week. And I know for some people that sounds outrageously expensive. I consider myself fortunate that I was able to afford that. It's not a negligible expense, but it's one that I was able to afford. And if I looked at in-person rate for therapists around here, I might save a little bit, but not a whole lot. So I went through their process, and you fill out this questionnaire about what issues you need help with, what kind of a therapist you're looking for. And I would tell you, if you're going to go through this, be honest in that survey about what you want. But when they match you up with a therapist, if you do your first visit and it doesn't seem like it's clicking, you don't owe that therapist anything. They advertise on their service that you can switch to a different therapist at any time. Take advantage of that. You are there, you're paying the money. Keep changing therapists if that's what you have to do until somebody feels like they're attentive and actually listening. I hit the jackpot on my first try, and the therapist that I got was ideal in more ways than one for the things that I needed help with. And so I started having these weekly meetings with the therapist, and at first, we did a lot of the typical things that you expect to do, talking about childhood and everything like that. And that was certainly helpful. But it wasn't crucial to my everyday mental health because, you know, there were things like from my college years that were still influencing how I react to my wife in certain situations. That isn't a day-to-day thing that's a huge negative. But by going through that, that was helpful. Where therapy really, really started to impact my day-to-day life is when we got through what are the bad things that happened to you throughout your life and this and that. I realized that therapy is something that ideally should be ongoing, because you are not able to unpack all of your issues all at once in a 3-week span, no matter how hard you try, because there are things in your life that you are good at faking until you get into a tight spot and then it unravels. That was certainly the case for me. We had gotten through what I considered to be my most important issues that I needed therapy for, and then something would happen in my life and I would be triggered with something that only comes up in a certain situation. And unlike previous years where I just kind of had to button up and kind of try and take it, now I had this outlet where I could talk to my therapist and say, okay, here's this thing that happened. Here's why it triggered me in this way. What the heck is going on? And so we would walk through it, and more than a couple times we got to the bottom of why this situation was causing me to react in such a way. So I'm just making good general progress, one little thing at a time. But then we go through fall, and this is where things really drastically get better. Something happened this fall. It is a situation, because we live up on the mountain here, there's snow, and I got a plow, and plowing has been a big source of stress for me. Without going into a lot of details, it's been stressful. And the first time it snowed this year, my anxiety went from about a 2 to like a 20 out of 10, all in the course of one evening. And I got through it, and in the next week in therapy, I told my therapist, I said, based on the reality of what was actually happening to me, my level of anxiety was not proportional. What was actually happening in terms of snow and ice and the realities of my plowing situation, the reality was about here, but my anxiety was way up here. And so I was cognizant enough to realize I'm suffering more than I should be from something that's not that bad. And typically the way that therapy calls go, at least I've experienced, is that the first 20 minutes, sometimes you're just trying to figure out if you have anything to talk about, and then something will trigger about 20 minutes in the thing, and then the last 10 minutes are like absolute gold. In this case, it was the last 2 minutes. Because I told the therapist, I was like, this is the situation. Reality is down here. My anxiety is way up here. I don't know why I'm all the way up here with my anxiety. And the therapist said, I think I'm going to send you some videos about cognitive distortions. And watch those, and we'll talk about them next week. And that word distortion jumped out at me. Because I'm a guitar player. We know what distortion is. I'm an engineer by education. I know what distortion is in a system. In our world, it means something gets gritty and dirty. But distortion is anything that takes something that's real and distorts it into something that it's not. And so if you heard me at the beginning of the video say that if you skip the ending 10 minutes, you're going to miss that, this is that part. So if you've not been paying attention so far, this is the real life-changing stuff for me. I started reading about cognitive distortions, and there's a bunch of them, but basically what it means is this. Reality happens. This distortion, this lens in your mind, takes what's really happening and creates some other version of reality that's distorted. And you don't look at reality, but you look at the distorted version that your mind produces, and you react to that. Now, we have all heard say somebody is making a mountain out of a molehill, or you're too serious about this, or I've had this language for this phenomenon for years, but I just thought of it as something, as this kind of, it's kind of in the system. There's nothing that you can do about it. It's just, yeah, you're taking something too seriously. You're making this more than it's not. I did not realize that there is an actual psychological phenomenon that has been studied and written about that describes this. Some of the distortions are downplaying the positive. So this distortion works out. Anybody who's on YouTube and gets comments knows about this. You can get 100 positive comments and then one negative one, and the negative one will stick with you for the rest of the day, and you'll forget about the positive ones. That is a cognitive distortion. Downplaying the positive means you have a gain curve for positive stuff that the more it gets, the less it matters. Where negative stuff, it can be a tiny little thing and it gets amplified. And it was helpful for me as an engineer to visualize a lens in my mind that is taking real things that happen and distorting it into something. I realized it's not just me. This is an actual thing that has been studied and documented. Another distortion is predicting the future, which is basically drawing conclusions from something that happened. Because this happened once, this is always going to happen from here on out. Another one is overgeneralizing. If this one person treats me bad, it means that pretty much everybody is going to treat me bad. It's all these ways of taking small things that happen and making them these big, terrible things. Another one is called catastrophizing, which is taking something bad that happens and assuming it's going to turn into this catastrophic thing. This is a thing that happens in your mind. And what I learned that was so valuable is that some of us have become so used to this happening, we aren't even aware that we're doing it. For most of our lives, we've been allowing little things that happen in reality to turn into these various distorted realities in our mind. We almost don't know how to, like, we have just forgotten that this is not real. What's real happened over here, but what we're looking at is not real. And it's been happening so often and for so long that it's just a part of how our brain works now. So just learning that there was a name for what I had been doing in my thoughts was helpful for me. And I was able to start thinking about whenever I would start feeling anxious about something, I would think back to, all right, what cognitive distortions am I engaging in right now? What small thing happened that I am turning into something big? And so as I researched more of this, it led me to a book called Feeling Good by David D. Burns, and I'll put a link to it in the description. And this book has single-handedly had a bigger effect on my mental health more than anything probably since I started medication way back in 2013. I think it was. And just for those of you who are only now finding out that I'm on medication, yes, I've been on a low dose of antidepressants ever since like 2013. And it was life-changing and probably saved my marriage, but you can refer back to my original video about that. But antidepressants did not fix the things that I've been talking about so far this year. It kept me above water, but it didn't keep me from falling out of the boat. Is a good metaphor. So what this book taught me is to understand the first thing that I learned from this book, and really if you take one thing away from this video, if you're somebody that deals with anxiety and depression, the one thing that that changed my view and can help you out to is this. Your moods do not create your thoughts. Your thoughts create your moods. And so here is what that means in a very real sense. If you are somebody who deals with anxiety and depression, you have no doubt had those periods where you're depressed and you're anxious, and then you start having the thoughts that go along with it. I have always felt that the mood was inevitable. There was nothing I could do about the mood. It was gonna arrive and take over, and the best I could hope for was just to wait it out. And so all throughout this year, as I'm getting better and better with my mental health, sleeping better, doing more things that I love with my business, learning about cognitive distortions, I still felt vulnerable to the specter of anxiety or depression. When it comes to visit, there's nothing I can do. I just have to wait it out. And I thought that all the negative thoughts that come along with that, all the cognitive distortions, I thought those were coming from the place of being depressed or anxious. It never occurred to me that my thoughts were inviting anxiety and depression in. And so when I heard him say in this book that your moods are caused by your thoughts, pardon my French, but my first reaction was, that is bullshit. So I was not receptive to what this book was proposing at first. I very much wanted to hang on to the idea that anxiety and depression were inevitable, and the best I could hope for was just to wait it out and to try and insulate myself from it with more sleep and exercise and that sort of thing. But what he was proposing in this book is that your thoughts lead you to those dark places. And I was resistant, but I decided I'm gonna keep reading anyway. What he laid out in the book was a cycle wherein you have these distorted thoughts caused by your cognitive distortion filters in your brain. Something in the world happens. You engage in one of the many cognitive distortions that have become embedded in your way of thinking, catastrophizing, downplaying the positive, overgeneralization, predicting the future, whatever, and you have these thoughts going. It almost happens subconsciously. You're not even aware that you're thinking them. But that starts a chemical process in your body, which is where emotions happen. Emotions are nothing more than different chemicals and different balances in your body. But you're not even aware of the emotions yet, because you're not aware of the emotions until you actually have a feeling. And a feeling is a physical sense of, like, when you're embarrassed about something and your face gets flushed and you feel hot. That's a physical sensation. That is a feeling that comes from an emotion. Another type of feeling is a tightness in your chest or a tightness in the back of your neck and in your shoulders, that feeling of anxiousness. Or in some cases, like I would experience on those days where I would come down to the barn and be overwhelmed, a gradual heaviness over your entire body. What he says in this book that completely has completely changed my life is that those feelings, so you have thoughts, you have emotions that turn into feelings. He said those feelings are temporary, but if they aren't disrupted, they will turn into a mood. And a mood is a lot harder to deal with. And what he proposed in this book that I have found to be true is that the automatic negative thoughts, they happen so fast. You're not even aware that you're having these automatic negative thoughts. The distorted thoughts based on a much tamer version of reality that gets distorted in your mind, that process happens so quickly you're probably not aware of it. But you're certainly aware that something is happening when you begin having a feeling. When you begin feeling that tightness, when you begin feeling anger, the hair on the back of your neck standing up. He said, what you need to do is when you become aware of the feeling, do not let that turn into a mood. Go back to your thoughts and think, what was I just thinking about? What cognitive distortion was I engaging with that caused a distorted version of reality to happen in my mind that started the trigger of emotions and chemical release in my body that is now causing this feeling? And what he said in the book is, he's like, I promise you, if you can find that thought and you can challenge it with reality, and he gives a step-by-step process for how to challenge those distorted thoughts, he said you can not only stop those feelings from turning into a mood that lasts for days or weeks, you can actually have those feelings just dissolve away. And again, as I'm reading this, or in my case, listening, because I listen to the audiobook as I go through the Kindle version, I thought, this is bullshit. Because I have felt vulnerable. Once bad feelings hit, I felt like there's nothing I can do but just sit there and let it turn into a mood and then just struggle to deal with that mood. But I tried it. And I'll never forget the first time I tried it and it worked. I was driving. I left the house to go out and buy groceries or whatever. And I was in a good mood when I left the house. I'm listening to one of the podcasts that I listen to on the way to the store. And I feel my mood start to change. And so I'm trying to do what the book says. I'm aware of a feeling, but I haven't been paying attention to my thoughts. I'm aware of a feeling. I feel this hopeless sense coming over me that is so different from what I left the house in. Before, the way that this would play out is I would just think, oh, here it comes again. Let me put on a happy face while I'm in the store and then go home and just lie in bed or just be grumpy for the rest of the evening and hope it goes away the next day. I just figured the mood's here. I got to deal with it. But this time, because of what I had literally just been listening to in the book the day before and the day of, I decided, let me try something different. So I realized I have this sinking, depressed feeling coming over me. And I think, all right, let me go back to my thoughts. What was I thinking about? What was I listening to? What kind of cognitive distortion was happening in my mind? And I realized the podcast that I was listening to is somebody that I respect, but they were saying some things that I definitely did not respect, and I thought that they were just hopelessly blind. And I could not believe how wrong they were getting it. And as I was listening to this person talk, I was internally getting more and more frustrated and angry that I cannot believe this person cannot see the BS that they are saying. Why can't they see this? And this had all been going on in my subconscious. I leave the house, I turn on the podcast, I listen to this person talk. I can't believe that somebody that I respect can be this dumb. That causes some emotions to be released at a chemical level, which causes feelings to start happening. And if I hadn't stepped in, that would have turned into a full-blown depressed mood that I would have carried with me back into the house. But instead, I decided to do what he says in the book. I went back to that thought and I said, hey, you don't even know this person. On top of that, who cares if they're being this dumb? It has no impact on you or your life. On top of that, you don't know the completeness of this person's thoughts. You don't know this person. They're not your friend. They mean nothing to you. The fact that you respect them and they're saying something you don't like, it has no bearing on your life. Nothing bad has happened here. This is me reversing the lens. Reality, a guy on a podcast that I like says some things. Through the distorted lens, it becomes all hope is lost because if this person's wrong, there's no hope for humanity. If they can't see where they're wrong, then what hope is there? It sounds crazy, but there are some of you out there who need to hear this. I flipped the lens around and I said, no. What really happened is a person I don't even know said a thing on a podcast that I disagree with, all I have to do is turn it off and stop listening. And it's like nothing has happened. And I told myself, nothing bad has happened. There is nothing to be upset about. Make note of what you disagree with, but then realize it has no impact on your life. And so after I said my little piece to myself, turned off the podcast, I waited. And let me tell you, within 5 minutes, that sense of dread and emptiness that had been starting to filter down through, it literally melted away. And it is the first time that I've experienced that I can remember. Certainly the first time that it's happened because of something that I did intentionally. I have had more instances where a mood like that came on me and stayed with me for a day or two than I can remember. But this was the first time that I tried, you know, what he's talking about in the book. And I just assumed, let's assume that this mood is happening because of something that I was thinking. Let's just assume for the sake of argument. If it doesn't work, I can just go back to saying this book is bullshit. I can just go back to doing things the way that I was. And life goes on. But let me just try and see if it works. And so I did it, and it worked. Then I tried it a week later when one of my kids got sick, and I had to stay up at the house. Instead of coming down to the barn, I had to stay with him. And when my kids are sick, boy, that whole catastrophizing distortion starts to, that lens goes from a 1X to a 10X, and listening to my kid cough next to me, I could feel this tightness, this anxiety coming over me. Oh, what if my kids have COVID? What if it's the flu? This, that, and the other thing. Meanwhile, my kid is perfectly happy, sitting on the couch, playing his iPad. He gets to miss school. He's happy. Nothing is wrong except the fact that he's coughing. And on top of that, by this time, we already knew it wasn't COVID because we'd given him a test. It's not a COVID. It's just most likely a cold, but I'm sitting there listening to him cough, and I'm finding myself getting into this anxious, worked up, you know, just this state where I can't be creative for my business. And this is how this affects all of you, because when I get like this, I can't produce. And so I did this again. I said, what thoughts was I just thinking that could have caused me to get to this tight, anxious spot? And I realized I've been sitting there for an hour listening to my kid cough, and my mind is in the background like a caged monkey running around screaming at the top of its lung that the world is ending because my kid has a cough and he's home from school. And so I realized that is a cognitive distortion. In reality, my kid is fine. He's happy. He has a little bit of a cough. We know it's not COVID. A week from now, I'm barely even going to remember that this happened. And within 5 minutes, the anxiety completely melted away. So this was all a couple of weeks ago. And since this time, I have had several other opportunities to try and use this new approach to thinking about my thoughts and my moods. And I can tell you, I have had the longest uninterrupted stretch of no serious bad moods, no serious anxiety, no serious depression that I can remember. And here's a thing that some of you might have struggled with, and that is the feeling that when things in your life are good, it's kind of cheating to assume that your mental health is better because nothing bad's happening. But here is what I have realized. Anybody in any sport practices, and they practice when they are healthy so that when they go out into competition where the stakes are real, they're more prepared. One of my pastimes is I watch mixed martial arts, and there is a reason that people get matched up against certain opponents, because you have to be prepared for what you're going to go in. You can't put somebody inexperienced with somebody who's experienced because it's literally too dangerous. You have to prepare when things are good so that when things are bad and there's real stakes on the line, you're better prepared to get through it. Mental health is the same way. If you do not take your mental health seriously while life is good, you will be ill-prepared to deal with the consequences when life gets bad. So part of me in the back of my mind has been saying, well, of course you're making so much progress with your mental health right now. Things are good. You haven't had any health scares this year. You haven't had any financial hardships like you did last year. But this stuff, this wouldn't have worked back then. And what I have realized is that maybe that's true. Maybe there are some bouts of depression that are purely, as my therapist says, are purely organic. They literally are just chemicals in your brain just getting out of whack. That may very well be true. And if that's the case, you'll deal with them someday and you'll get through with them the best that you can. But the fact is, not all depression and anxiety is like that. And even when times are good, as I have talked about this year, from a reality standpoint, has been less stressful than either of the two previous years, but I have still dealt with anxiety and depression on an ongoing basis. Even when things are good, anxiety and depression do not let you rest. And what I have learned that has been life-changing is that you do not have to be defenseless against them if you learn that at least some of them are coming from your own distorted thoughts. And if you learn to challenge those distorted thoughts, once you start feeling feelings, you can completely dismantle a depressive mood or an anxious mood coming on that could last for days or weeks. It might not work every time, but some of the times it will. And so at a minimum, it allows you to enjoy the good periods of your life that you deserve to enjoy without constantly being threatened by a foul mood. It allows you to fend off bad moods. It gives you an actual method of defense. And for me, this was life-changing because I felt defenseless. I felt like I've got medication working in my favor, trying to keep my serotonin and everything balanced. I try and get good sleep, and I try and exercise, and I build up as much insulation as I can, but once depression shows its face, I'm powerless against it. That is not true. I can actually fight back against it on the thought level. And so what happens 6 months from now or a year from now if something bad happens? I will have to put what I'm talking about now to the test when the stakes are higher. But what I have learned is that if depression is trying to drag you down, let's say you're in a boat out on a lake and depression is threatening to flip the boat over. Sometimes the depression might be so strong that you can't stop it and you end up getting dumped in the water. And that's where medication can, depending on how you react to medication can literally save your life, because some people get dumped into that water and they don't feel like treading water. And that's the end of that. Medication, for some people, when it works, gives you the strength to tread water. It's kind of like a life preserver. It keeps you from going under. But the goal is not to tread water. The goal is to stay in the boat. And what I've learned this year is that if you don't at least start challenging negative distorted thoughts in your mind, that is like sitting cross-armed in the canoe, and when depression tries to tip you over, you just lean over and you just go under, and you're stuck there now having to tread water because you weren't even willing to fight. If you were really in a boat and somebody was trying to tip you over, you would fight back because you don't want to go in the water. You don't want to have to tread, even if you know you're not going to drown because you got your life preserver vest on, You don't want to get in the water. You want to stay in the boat. And so you fight to keep the boat upright. For me, that is what this is. And by the way, the technique that I'm describing here is called cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT. And so if you go to a therapist, if you buy into what I'm talking about here, find yourself a therapist that is licensed to do therapy using cognitive behavioral therapy. Or if you can't afford a therapist, just buy this book or any book that talks about cognitive behavioral therapy. It at least gives you something to fight with. It at least puts an oar in your hand where you can kind of smack at depression trying to turn your boat over, or at least lean the other direction to keep it from capsizing. I don't know what happens when the next time a contractor rips me off and I lose a bunch of money, or the next time somebody I know almost dies in the hospital. I don't know whether I'll end up in the water or not, but what I will tell you is that I'm going to fight like hell not to capsize, because now I understand that it is possible. Before, I just believed that you sit in the boat and when it starts to tip, well, that's all she wrote. Now you just do your best to tread water. I now know that that's not the case. You can keep the boat from capsizing. Maybe not always, but at least sometimes. And it costs you nothing to try. Now, the important thing is the issue is time and it's speed. You are like, when you are normal and happy, you're like dry ground. When emotions start churning and negative feelings, you start becoming aware of them, that's like water sprinkling on the surface of the dry ground. If you challenge the negative thoughts and you turn off the hose, it might take a few minutes for that ground to dry out in the sun. But it can and it will dry out and you'll be back to normal. If you wait and you let that negative thought hose run and you let the water gets soaked into the ground, it becomes a mood. And that mood soaks through to your core. And at that point, it takes so much longer for it to dry out. And it's the same way with a mood. If you can fight anxiety and depression at the feeling level by challenging your thoughts, you can avoid it turning into a mood, because a mood is so much harder and takes so much longer to get rid of. So that is why I say that this was a great year for me. I feel better and more level and more even now than I have in a really long time. And most important, I don't feel vulnerable and I don't feel helpless to my own body chemistry and my own moods. And that is going to have a profound effect on my ability to run this business, to produce content for all of you, to interact with my members, to show up on camera with a smile, to make wise business choices. I know this was long, and I know that it was not a topic that everybody needs to hear, but for those of you who need to hear it, I hope that you listen, and it could be life-changing. It certainly has been for me. And so I'm going to go celebrate New Year's Eve and look forward to 2023 and all that comes with it. And I wish a happy and prosperous new year for all of you as well.